Thank you. Good morning, everybody. As announced, I will speak about randomness and especially about all the sources of randomness. In fact, I am a bit familiar with the topic since I love to perform data analysis. I was given the challenge to study and to work on physical sources of randomness. So I did during 3 years, and I was trying and succeeding in building tools to detect anomalies in a random number, so sequences of 0 and 1, so to detect anomalies or patterns, and also to model anomalies. And now I work since 4 years as an IT security consultant, where I perform several tasks, like design review, the secure development lifecycle, code reviews, threat modeling, log analysis, and of course now I contribute to the GDPR. So we will speak about randomness, and we often hear that randomness is widely used. I just put some example in the context of a web application. We will use it to encrypt the traffic, to manage, to handle session for our user, or to restrict our API endpoint, and so on. So we really use it very, very often. And for our generator, we will expect two main criteria, two main properties. The first one is the distribution. We expect our random number to be uniform. We don't want to see any patterns that will be generated more often than the other. And we also expect, of course, our number to not be predictable. We can observe some exploits that already exist in the wild. I quote here my three preferred one. The first one, How I Met Your Girlfriend, the author leveraged the lack of the predictability of the PHP session ID to predict a valid session token in Facebook. So it was a lack of predictability. The second one is the famous PlayStation 3 fail, where Sony protected its applications by signing all of them, so with a private key. And in this signature, this digital signature has a strong properties, that is, never use twice the same random number. Of course it happened, and what it happens, you can recover the private key, and what it means is that you could sign your own application and load it successfully on the PlayStation 3. And the last one, Mind Your P's and Q's, refer to P and Q prime number in RSA public key. And what the author found is that the generation of the prime number was lacking of uniformity. So lots of prime numbers was reused multiple times. And so from a public key, you could take the modulus, compute a simple PGCD, it is pretty fast, no cost, and so recover one of the prime number. And if you have the prime number, you can rebuild the private key, the associated private key. That's all. So this is three main examples. And today in my talk, I will show you similar things with an old pseudo-random number generator, so an algorithm which takes a seed, apply the algorithm, get a random number, apply the algorithm on this previous number, get the next one, and so on. So I will show you how an old and weak pseudo-random generator allows me to predict next valid token, any next valid token. So if you think about a session identifier, it can be, it can cause lots of damage for your business. And it works only from one token, and it is an offline and brute force attack. I will do this, and I will show you step by step how the attack works. So the first step is to know what assumption we have to make the attack works. Of course, we need a token. Not very difficult. Then the token need to come from a Java application. I will explain later why. But this you can learn it by just some by just some information gathering, you can learn that the server behind is seems to be a Java application. Or it might be a JavaScript application, but only in one case if the JavaScript engine was implemented in Java, because it will use the same pseudo-random number generator. And my last assumption is that the token generation function is a simple function with a simple logic, but it is not rare to see this kind of function when you do some code review. And of course, in this function, you will call the mat.random function of Java. So why Java and why mat.random? Here I reproduced in Python what the function mat.random does in Java. In the function getNextFloat, it explains that mat.random generates a floating number between 0 and 1. How it proceeds? It takes two consecutive states of the pseudo-random generator. It keeps only the 26 and 27 most significant bits. It concatenates it, and it maps it in a floating number between 0 and 1. And the pseudo-random generator, getNextLCG, is a linear congruential generator. So what it means is that it takes three parameters, M, A, and B. They are public. You can even find it on the value on Wikipedia. And it takes the current state, it multiplies by A, it adds B, and it reduces it to always stay below 48 bits, the value of the length of M. So this is our mat.random function in Java. Now the token generation function. I have a char set. Let's say it is base 64. And to build my token, I request the mat.random. I get a float between 0 and 1, and I map it to an index in my char set. And so I take the character at this index, and I append to my token. And I reproduce until I reach the length of my token. So if we summarize what we have from the pseudo-random generator to the character we can observe in the token, we have S1 and S2, the two consecutive states of our generator. It is 48 bits long, and they are linked together. From those two internal states, we deduce one floating number in 0,1, and from this floating number, we deduce an index in our char set. So if from the character in my token, I can go back to the internal state, S1 or S2, of my generator, it's everything is done. I can generate any next valid token just by applying my function with the state I retrieved, and I say how many characters I want next, because everything is consecutive. So now I will show you an example how we do this. And since everything is consecutive, I even only need to retrieve the internal state of the first character of my token, because all the others I deduce from the previous one. So let's apply it on an example. My token starts with a F. So the first thing I have is to retrieve the float that was used to get this F. And since my token generation function map directly the range 0,1 with the char set AB until a slash, I know by the letter in which range my float is. For F, for instance, it is between 5 and 6 over 64. So now I have a range for my float. I want to go back to my internal state. And by definition of mat.random, my float is a given X divided by 2 to the power of 53. This X is the concatenation of two other numbers, X1 and X2, And those two numbers are the 26 and the 27 most significant bit of my two consecutive internal state. So if I focus only on the 20 most significant bit of my inequality, I get that x1 is comprised between two numbers. I have a range, and instead of having 26 bits to brute force, I only have 20 bits to brute force. And if I go back from x1 to s1, I know the 26 most significant bits, so I have to add 22 bits. I don't know nothing about it. So I have only 2 to the power 42 possible value for my internal state. And today, 2 to the power 42 test to perform is really fast. So if we summarize what we have, let's say you have a token 64 character long, where you use base64 char set. So you have, theoretically, 2 to the power 384 possible values. With a perfect random number generator, it means more than 300 bits of randomness. But in reality, with our mat.random function, we know that the token 60 character long is only is fully determined by its first character. And to retrieve this first character, I have only 2 to the power 42 tests to perform. It's a brute force attack, so it is easy to parallelize. I can run all tests independently. It has no costly operation. The most costly one is the call to the pseudo random number generator, and it is simply a modular multiplication on 48 bits. So today it is nothing. And I made some estimation with Amazon Cloud Computation, and with a 12 instance of an EC2, it will take you only 1 hour, and it will cost you only $55. So to retrieve your token, and then to be able to predict all next valid token. So the effective randomness is only 42 bits. So we might have some false good idea for remediation with this mass.random. Because we have several issues. The main issue is that the range, the floating number between 0 and 1 are directly mapped to our char set, and this is the main issue. So you might want to shuffle the char set before each character selection, so that this direct mapping is totally broken. Or you might want to break the relationship by making random calls to mats.random and just discard the result, just to break the linearity. Or you may want also to reseed the pseudo-random generator, so to change the seed. And if you change the seed, you change all the chain of consecutive numbers. So in your token, you will break the linearity. But all of those remediations are useless, because still our internal state is only 48 bits. So 48 bits is just 64 times more than what I showed. So 60 times more test, 64 times more expensive. $3,000, it might not be a big deal depending on the business you target. So to conclude, I was really surprised that in 2018, linear congruential generators are still in use, at least by Java. It is well known since many years that there are weak sources of randomness. Of course, I said we need uniformity and non-predictability. And a linear congruential generator apply a linear relation, so it is fully predictable. So hence, just be sure of the internal random number generator of your programming language, and stop to use a linear congruential generator. Thank you.
Okay, maths like that just kills my brain, but I'm guessing you guys actually have more, so...
Thank you, that was very interesting. So I'm assuming that this method random is used a lot in Java apps?
Yes, every programming language have a method to get a random number. In PHP, you will find empty round, and so on. So this is the default one that, in fact, lots of developers will use. I need a random number generator. I take the documentation of my language, and I will find it. Fine, I have a number. I can go next in my code.
So is this going to be fixed?
I don't think so, because it's not really the responsibility of the programming language. The programming language offers a method, but if you check the documentation, you have big warnings saying that, be careful, it's not secure. So you need to find another way. So I am more familiar with PHP. For instance, in PHP, you will have empty round. It's not recommended. You can then use OpenSSL library ones or random bytes, which use other sources of randomness, which are more secure. So you have different choices, and it is up to the developers to know, depending on what it needs, which function to use.
Okay. So, at least then for future reference, if developers of a language put in random generators, maybe they should add insecure to the function name?
In Java, I don't know.
No, but in general, I mean, if you're providing developers with a random number generator and it's not safe to use,
yeah,
to put a little bit more effort into getting that message across, I think.
So I didn't hear the lesson.
Well, just saying, if you develop a language and you provide developers with a random number generator,
yeah,
that is not safe, you can put as many disclaimers in the documentation as you want. People are going to use it.
Yes.
So, yeah.
But it is written, so it's the responsibility of anyone.
Right. Thank you very much.
Thanks. Any more questions in the room? Oh, okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.